Hey, what's up? Alex here. After watching a number of Wi-Fi 7 routers review videos on YouTube, I realized many of them don't really recommend getting it, and the reason is simply because at the time of the video, the Wi-Fi 7 specs had yet to be finalized. But in the beginning of this year, 2024, the standard has finally been published. Then just nice, in the last few months, there are a number of Wi-Fi 7 whole home mesh systems getting released here in Singapore. At the time of shooting this video, there are a few models from TP-Link, two models from ASUS, and just one model from Netgear. Netgear will have an entry model coming pretty soon. You can already check out the details on their website. As for the other brands like Linksys, they are not released in Singapore yet. Same case for the Amazon Eero series. You can't even find it in Amazon.sg. But apparently, it was bundled in some of the ISP plans. Thanks to one of my viewers for sharing that info. And so, similar to my Wi-Fi 6 mesh video, I'm going to do my testing, show you the test results, and give you my recommendations of which mesh system to buy. But before we look at the models, I just want to briefly talk about Wi-Fi 7. Wi-Fi 7 comes with three new distinct technologies: MRU, pre-amber puncturing, and MLO, multi-link operation, which to me is the biggest differentiator here. In Wi-Fi 6E, they introduced a new 6 GHz band. So in total, you have three bands now: 2.4 GHz, 5 GHz, and 6 GHz. In the past, a device can only connect to one of these bands at any one time. Regardless of whether you have the different bands split into different network SSID, or you have them all combined into one single network, back end, the device only connects to one single band. What MLO is able to do is letting your device connect to multiple bands all together at the same time. The result of this is vastly improved throughput, and also when encountering interference or heavy load in a certain band, it can automatically switch to other frequency bands. The reason why I'm bringing this up is because my testing for these Wi-Fi 7 models is going to focus a lot in this aspect. And the thing is, different companies implement MLO a little differently from one another. TP-Link, ASUS, and Netgear have all kindly sent me their products for this video. Let's look at the hardware first. Starting from the cheapest is the TP-Link Deco BE25. Unfortunately, they only sent me a 2-pack, while my test is always based on a 3-node setup. So I'm going to drop this from my testing. Next is also from TP-Link, the Deco BE65. This is a BE11000 tri-band model. TP-Link standard design in this cylinder shape and in white color. For the ports, you have 4x2.5G. These can be WAN or LAN. So this is good if your ISP plan is 1GB or 2GB or 3GB is fine as well. Next is the ASUS BT10. This is a BE18000 tri-band model, also standard ASUS design, slightly taller than my current XT8. In terms of ports, you have a 1G WAN or LAN, 10G WAN or LAN, and a 10G LAN port. I find the port arrangement here is a bit weird. Because you will most likely use a 10G WAN port for your ISP connection, then it's most certain that you will want to get a separate switch and have the switch connect to the 10G LAN so that all your other nodes that's going to be wired can be more than 1G. We are talking about a 10G or at least a 2.5G switch, which is not going to be cheap. Of course, if your ISP speed is just 1GB or if you're only doing wireless backhaul, then all of these don't matter. Next up is the TP-Link Deco BE85. This is a BE22000 tri-band model. The size of this is pretty big, about the same as my 2-liter water bottle. In terms of ports, this is an interesting one because you have an SFP Plus port where you can either use this or the normal 10G Ethernet. Then you have another one more 10G and 2x2.5G ports. All of these ports can be used for either WAN or LAN. Technically, I think this SFP Plus port should be able to connect to a switch with SFP uplink or maybe even to another node as a backhaul. I've asked TP-Link these questions, but sadly, they couldn't give me a definite answer. For the last two models, they are all quad band models, meaning they have an additional 5 GHz band dedicated for wireless backhaul. First is the ASUS BQ16. I believe the Q stands for quad band, and this is a BE25000 model. Sadly, no black color option this time like the XT8. In terms of ports, you have a 10G WAN or LAN, a 1G WAN or LAN, a 10G LAN, and 2x1G LAN. So similar situation as the ASUS BT10. If your ISP is 3GB, 5GB, or 10GB, then you would not really want to use those 1G ports here. Okay, lastly, the most expensive model is the Netgear Orbi 970. This is a BE27000 quad band model. I actually like the design a lot this time. The size and weight of this is massive. Would be perfect if they could scale this a little smaller. Let me put a can beside to show you the big contrast. Orbi always has a dedicated node for the main router and different satellite nodes. For the router, it has a total of 6 ports, 10G for WAN, and for LAN, a 10G and 4x2.5G. The satellite nodes has 3 ports, 1 10G and 2 2.5G. Very similar port combination as the TP-Link BE85, which is what I think makes the most sense. Before jumping into the test scenario, I want to share my experience and give a review of the setup process. Okay, usually I don't do this because setting up a mesh system is relatively straightforward. But unfortunately, this time, I really have no choice but to drop one of the models from the test as I just can't get the system up and running properly consistently. And that's the ASUS BT10. Some of the issues I encounter are not being able to add a wireless node at the exact spot where I want to place it. So to resolve this is of course to place it near the router and finally able to add a node to the setup successfully. Note that this is not an issue with the other models at all. Because I need to do a lot of testing, I need to keep rotating the mesh systems, which means powering down one system and then power up another mesh system. Doing this many times. Whenever I boot up or reboot the BT10, sometimes it will have red LED at the router node, which means no ISP connection. Or sometimes blue LED at one of the nodes, which feel like it lost the configuration to the setup entirely. End up, I will have to do a hard reset and redo the setup. Repeat this process a few times. I even swap out one of the nodes since I have one spare around, just in case if it's hardware fault. It's like every time when I reboot the BT10, I will have some PTSD that something wrong is going to happen. For the ASUS BQ16, it's also not very smooth, but at least still manageable. Compare this to the setup with TP-Link. Over there, it's really very easy, and every time when I'm rotating the mesh system to a TP-Link model, I'm like very confident that everything will be up and running within the first try. No troubleshoot required. For Netgear Orbi, there are a few occasions where the satellite nodes couldn't sync. Then I'll press the sync button at the back of the nodes. After a couple of times, it's okay. The web UI and mobile app stability for the ASUS is also not as good. Overall, it's an easy ranking to give for the installation setup. Number one, TP-Link, followed by Netgear, then ASUS. Now for my test setup, it will be the same as my Wi-Fi 6 video. My current ISP is a 5 Gbps plan with StarHub. First router node is placed inside the DB board. Second node will be placed in my home office room. This will be wired. Then I will have the third node placed in my master bedroom. This will be wireless. I will always make sure that the third node is getting an uplink from the office node instead of getting from a router node. As for test ports, I try to mimic our actual living habits where we will most frequently use our phones or laptops there. The first port is sitting at the furthest end of the sofa in the living room. Second spot is in a common toilet with the door closed. Over here, I will make sure that the device is connected to the office node for the best performance. The third node is in the bedroom at the furthest end of the bed from the node. The fourth and last spot is sitting right at my desk in my home office room. For each spot, I will be doing a total of 10 speed tests using 2 different devices, 1 laptop and 1 phone. This means that for each mesh system, I'll be taking the average from 40 speed test results. For the phone, I'm using the Google Pixel 8 and using the Wi-Fi Man app server from Ubiquiti to do the test. For laptop, I'll be using the Ookla speed test, but instead of running it via a web browser, I will be testing with the desktop app. The choice of laptop here is the Razer Blade 14, which is also the sponsor for today's video. This is the new 2024 Razer Blade 14 laptop in Mercury White on this very sleek, stylish chassis crafted from premium materials, making it as attractive as it is durable. It is the most portable Razer Blade out there, weighing at just 1.84 kg and less than 18mm thin. It's powered by the new AMD Ryzen 9 processor that features an improved AI engine, accelerating your day-to-day workflow. The build quality is unmatched, with a very sturdy hinge tilt with precision. You have a stunning 14-inch QHD display with a 240Hz refresh rate. The keyboard backlight is powered by arguably the best lighting system, Razer Chroma. Looks simply amazing with these low-profile keys. The laptop has a battery life of 8 hours and able to charge up to 80% in just 1 hour. And of course, the new model has upgraded to Wi-Fi 7 for faster downloads and a more stable connection when gaming. Definitely go check out the all-new Razer Blade 14 at their official website to find out more. Now, let's look at the test results for each of the spots. First port is the one in the living room sofa testing the router node. I've included my current Wi-Fi 6 ASUS XT8 result for comparison as well, and you can see it's about the same performance as the Deco BE65. ASUS BQ16 significantly beat all the rest for download speed. Similarly, the Orbi 970 outperformed the rest on the upload speed. Second spot is the one in the common toilet testing the office node, which has a wired connection to the router node. This is the hardest spot among all, and that's why the speed you see across all models is relatively low. The only standout result here is the download speed from the Deco BE85. Besides that, the performance is about the same for every other model. Next, for the third spot, this is the bedroom, testing the bedroom node, which is using a wireless backhaul with an uplink from the office node. Here is where you can see a big difference between Wi-Fi 6 versus Wi-Fi 7, where it's more than double the performance you get from the Orbi 970. The Deco BE85 is very close, losing just a bit on the upload speed, while the ASUS BQ16 is struggling here. I tried testing it at different days and different timing just in case I got it wrong, but still, I can't get something close with the other two models. Last spot is in my home office room, sitting at my desk. This is like testing the Wi-Fi speed directly without any interference. Based on this result, I think this is pretty accurate if you scale price with performance. And again, this is quite a big difference between Wi-Fi 6 and Wi-Fi 7. Now for the last graph is the average performance from all the 40 test results. I think this final result made quite a lot of sense. The Orbi 970 did exceptionally well for upload speed, while both the TP-Link models, Deco 65 and Deco 85, have a very balanced and consistent performance on both ends. Alright, time for my recommendations. My first recommendation for a budget pick is actually to stick with Wi-Fi 6. The ASUS XT8, which is my best overall Wi-Fi 6 mesh system, is still very value for money considering the price now for Wi-Fi 7 mesh and the performance gain. Okay, unless you are setting up a fresh new setup or your ISP plan is more than 3GB, then you can consider getting the Deco BE65, which is the cheapest in my list today. If you're looking for something that is easiest for normal consumers, almost a plug and play experience, then I will go for the Orbi 970. In the beginning of the video, I mentioned every company implements MLO a bit differently. Both TP-Link and ASUS did not have MLO enabled by default. Okay, don't ask me why, I also don't understand. Only the Orbi 970, I don't need to configure and fine-tune anything. It is also the only one that you can just go with a single network SSID, and all my smart home devices can connect to it with no issues. But I'll say one thing is you can't even find the settings for MLO or even 6GHz band, even if you want to play around with it. So might not be suitable for those pro consumers. Okay, now for my final recommendation, the Wi-Fi 7 mesh system that I'm confident to recommend to all the early adopters is the Deco BE85. In terms of price and performance, features, reliability, user experience, all of this put together is the most balanced overall. I like that their MLO is the only one that's able to use all the bands, 2.4 GHz, 5 GHz and 6 GHz. This is verified using the Wi-Fi Man app. On the smart home aspect, the Deco series supports Matter, so it's a Matter controller that's able to control your Matter devices. I have not tested this, but it would be awesome if your Matter coverage in the house is the same as your Wi-Fi network. Okay, as always, it's time to wrap up with some closing thoughts. Wi-Fi 7 mesh system is expensive. Like I mentioned, it's more for the early adopters or if you're doing a fresh new home network setup today. The heat generated out is much higher this time, so try to keep it well ventilated. For houses that are implementing wireless backhaul, the upgrade is quite significant. You are definitely going to see good results with Wi-Fi 7. As for quad band versus tri-band, I don't feel that the additional band for wireless backhaul is as important as compared to last time anymore. Actually, what bothers me more is the size of this. I think it's going to hurt the aesthetics of the house. So if you're looking for the cleaner setup, check out this video next where I shared the easiest way to implement an AC plus AP setup. Lastly, I'm doing some giveaway for my Singapore viewers. If you drop a good mesh Wi-Fi in the comments, you will stand a chance to win some of my coasters. Well, thanks for watching. Please like, subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one. Bye.